Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Sabah al khair. Thank you, Dr. Hamilton, for the kind introduction. I think it's very hard to come and speak after Dr. Samir. I think Dr. Samir is considered as a regional leader when it comes to quality. So today I'll be talking about quality evolution in the era of healthcare consolidation. Cannot believe it's already 2020. Time flies very fast. And the first month is almost over, January. I don't know how many of you knows where is the name January came from, or the word January came from. Anybody knows? No. All right. So January, in Latin, Januarius, is named after Janus, the god of beginning and transition in Roman mythology. As you can see in the image, Janus' eyes can look simultaneously, backward and forward. As I was thinking about my presentation, I thought about all the changes which took place in the healthcare industry in the last decades. A lot of mergers, acquisitions, consolidations, regulations, and more regulations. Carrots and sticks, KPI became more of a carrot and sticks lately. There is a real transformation in healthcare. And of course, managing quality and accreditation is an integral part of this transition. So in this session, I'll go over some of the successful initiatives which we took within our laboratory network. Hopefully, you can adapt it in your settings. So before I start, by show of hand, how many of you are working in a standalone hospital or a standalone center which have no affiliation with any other healthcare? Only maybe two. How many of you are working as are part of a network of hospitals with affiliation? Almost everybody in the room. Point made. In a recent healthcare media survey, 159 healthcare executives were asked about their merger and acquisitions and partnership deals. 87% of the respondents said that their organization were expected to both explore potential deals and complete deals that were underway in the next 12 to 18 months. Only 13% of the respondents said that their organization were not planning for any merger and acquisitions. So mergers and acquisitions are here to stay. So we'll go over how can we manage quality in this world of mergers and acquisitions. I think very soon we're gonna run out of standalone hospitals. Everybody is going through mergers and acquisition. I think we all know the reasons, mainly economy of scale and efficiencies. While maintaining the same quality, they will try to save cost. This from the American Hospital Association. So the green columns show the number of hospitals. The blue columns show the number of deals. As you can see, a lot of activities when it comes to merger and acquisition. Between 1995 and 2015, over 1,400 hospitals went through mergers and acquisitions. So you're gonna have the CEOs of those organizations sign the deal, flashlights, pictures, and then they tell us in the QA department, go ahead and handle this. So QA operation, HR have to do a lot of work. So in the QA, once the merger and acquisition are done, we have to deal with a number of regulation and accreditation requirement. So I'll share with you some of what we have to deal with here, of course, in the UAE. We have 10 laboratories in the country, 7 in the Emirates of Abu Dhabi, 3 in Dubai. So I'll share with you some of the regulation that we have to make sure that we are in compliance with. So in Abu Dhabi, of course, we have to be in compliance with the Department of Health. We have the OSHA regulation, which is very similar to the US OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health, although I think OSHAD is more stringent. We have here in Dubai, Dubai Health Authority, College of American Pathologists. 8 of our labs are accredited by CAP. You know, in Dubai, you have to be the best, the biggest, the largest. So we're the largest network of CAP accredited lab. We have to be in compliance with ISO, with the latest demand circular, the latest circular from the Emirates National Accreditation System and the Department of Health. ISO became mandatory, and a lot of labs have to be accredited within the next 3 to 5 years. Joint Commission, international, although this is a hospital standard, but maybe 76 out of the total Joint Commission standards are applicable to the lab. So we need to be in compliance with this as well. The labs that have blood bank, we are accrediting them with AABB, American Association of Blood Bank. So a lot of regulations, a lot of standards that we want to make sure that we are in compliance with. So any changes to any of that standard will require a lot of thinking before we make changes to our policy. So for example, later today, the president and the CEO of the JCI will be speaking about the latest version of the Joint Commission. If they make slight change, maybe to the physician privileges or to the referral lab evaluation, can I just go back tomorrow to work and make the change in my policy? The answer is no. I have to take a step back, look at the big picture. What are the regulations when it comes to CAP, referring to referral lab evaluation, ISO, local regulation, and then we can make the change. So now we need to learn when you have a lot of merger acquisition, you have a network, making changes a lot of time will require a lot of thinking before you change your policy to make sure that you're in compliance with all the regulations. This is a picture of our monthly quality meeting. Those are the leaders of our laboratory, the 10 labs here in the UAE. So we meet monthly to discuss a number of things. Any quality issues, but we also discuss standardization. Whenever we want to make any changes, we want to make sure that all the 10 labs in the country are doing the same thing the same way. If we have, let's say, a centrifuge, why do we have to have 10 different standard operating procedure for centrifuge? Why don't we have one and distribute it across the network? I think we need to use technology. I think Arabhealth's theme this year is connectivity. So we want to make sure that we are connected across our network whenever possible. We want to make sure that we use the same SOPs across all of our laboratories whenever possible. Those are the number of applicable standards to our laboratories, CAP and ISO. I just selected two out of the seven regulations. 10,000 standards applicable to us. So imagine if I have to deal with every lab as a standalone entity. We're going to have so many policies. When I check our total number of policies 3 years ago, I found that we have 3,500 policies and procedures. But then we came back, we said we cannot continue like this. Every time we add a hospital, we add a lab, we can add new policies, it doesn't work that way. So we have to consolidate them. We have to use the same policies. Proficiency testing policy, test method validation policy, QC policy, whenever possible, we can apply it across the network to avoid duplication of work. The beauty of this as well, when you get inspected, you have to address the citation across the entire 10 laboratories rather than one lab at a time. So it's very beneficial for us to use the same policies whenever possible. Harmonization and standardization. Very interesting word, but you're going to see a lot of it. So if we go to PubMed and you search the word harmonization, 20 years ago, you can find only a handful number of articles discuss harmonization. All of a sudden, in the last few years, there's a spike. So why? Does harmonization affect the average Joe who works in a small hospital or only the big multi-centers? I think it does affect everybody, even if you work in a small hospital, because you want to make sure that everybody is working in harmony. You want to make sure you don't have a lot of silos in your organizations. People not need to talk to each other. Maybe something as simple as your standard operation procedure templates need to be shared across the hospital so everybody will use the same templates and so on. So harmonization is a very important item that we need to be considering when it comes to consolidation and mergers and acquisitions. There are different definitions for harmonization. It depends on your background and where you work in, if you are pharmacy, radiology, whatever. But in the clinical lab, this is a definition of harmonization from the clinical and lab standard institute. Generally, you want to make sure that your system is working in harmony. Now I'm going to get to the last part of the presentation where I'm going to walk you through three examples of how we're able to adapt harmonization and standardization. And as Dr. Samir mentioned earlier, improve the quality because quality is a journey, is not a destination. So any accreditation will fall, any accreditation standard will have some sort of a component related to the quality system essential, those 12 quality system essentials. So I selected three so that we can have example of what we have done in our lab. So I'll talk about specimen management, assessment, and KPIs. So the first one, before I go into it, I think those numbers are very familiar to most of you. Medical errors are the third leading cause of death in the US. Almost 400,000 people in the US die every year due to medical errors. In the clinical lab, we are doing slightly better, I think due to automation, yet we're still struggling with the pre-analytical errors. Almost 70% of the error occur at the pre-analytical phase, and mainly around specimen collection. So I know this slide is kind of slightly busy, but there are a lot of important statistics that you can look at. Up to 1% of collection tubes are mislabeled. Up to 1%. 7.4% of patient armbands are missing or contain erroneous information. Demographic information. Is that serious? I think it is. Wrong demographic information can be very serious because many times you can assign the wrong reference ranges. It happened to my wife last year. We took her to hospital, she got admitted, and when I check her armband, they put male instead of female. I mean, I know she's a boss at home, but that doesn't mean they need to put that she's a male because most likely the hormones reference ranges will be different. So what do we do about this? Historically, maybe 30 years ago, it's very hard to look at the historical result and compare it to the current result. But now with the use of automation, of course, we can use delta check. So we can have the lab information system automatically check the results against the historical result. If there's any big changes, big differences, it will flag to us. So there are a number of sensitive analytes that we can use, the MCV, albumin, hemoglobin, and so on. And we want to make sure that, of course, we set the time limitation and the percentage difference. Automation have done a great job in the clinical lab. So I thought I'll share with you three pictures of our lab in Abu Dhabi and the sample journey. We'll walk you through the sample journey to see are there a lot of chances for mistakes or not. So when the specimen comes to our lab and it gets centrifuged, we put it in the pre-analytical automation. So the specimen will, the laser beam will do an image capture to check for hemolysis, ectopic, lipemia. And if there is any, it will come out to ask us if we can run the test. If not, it will check the volume. If the volume is short, again, the specimen will come out. If everything is fine, then it will be decapped. And then it will go through the belt. Thank you. So when it goes through the belt, it's going to go into different analyzers. So it will go through the Ferris analyzer. It will run the chemistry test, the CMP, liver panel, and so on. And the result will be automatically verified, again, use of technology. Then it will go to the second analyzer. It will have the immunoassay and so on. Again, the result will be automatically verified, and then it will go all the way to the end. So when it comes to the end, it will be recapped. It will go directly to the refrigerator. It will be stored. 7 days later, it will be dropped at the biohazard bag. So seamless, very small chance of error. As I mentioned earlier, only 10% of the error occur at the analytical phase. So that's why we really need to focus and work collectively with the other department, with nursing, with phlebotomy, with everybody in the hospital to make sure that we decrease the number of pre-analytical errors. So if I can use the Swiss cheese model here, what do we need to do to avoid doing harm to the patient? We use technology. Can talk about orientation and competency, failure mode and effect analysis, delta check, whatever it takes to make sure that we save patients' life. So I think that's a good example that you can replicate in your laboratory. The last one I would like to, the second one I want to go, share with you, assessment and accreditation. You see those smiley faces? This is a picture of our staff after successful inspections. They're smiling, they're happy because they are the one who made us succeed. So what do we do? How did we advance our quality to make sure that everybody is happy? Few things. First thing, we train our frontline staff on all accreditation standard. So we started this back in 2015. We sit with the department, we go standard by standard to explain to them what is required, how are we compliant with the standard, and where are the elements of compliance. We created electronic checklist with hyperlink, and they learned. And then next year, we can cross-train them in a different department. They learn new standard and so on. Because the longer they stay, the more checklists they learn win for us, because they can handle any inspection at any time. We don't have to be there in the lab to deal with inspections. I still recall 20 years ago when the inspections team used to come, they deal with the supervisors. Nowadays, inspection teams a lot of time interact with the lab staff. That's why training your frontline staff on accreditation standard is very important. Second thing we do, whenever we have citation, we address it across the network. Third, we conduct comprehensive self-inspections. So many accreditation standards require us to do mock inspections and self-inspections. So a lot of time we ask lab A to inspect lab B, lab B to inspect lab C, and so on. And many times the internal citations will be much more than external inspections. The last thing we do is frequent quality assurance audit. So even our auditing process continue to evolve. So we start with basic audit, where every month we have an audit checklist, we audit all the departments. Then we added more and more requirements. 2016, we added more. We decreased the frequency of the audit, but we make it more extensive. And then we did something interesting last year. We added the non-technical department to our audit schedule. Our HR. How do you manage an HR in a network of hospitals or lab? Where do you gonna put the staff file? Is it in your flagship hospital, or you're gonna have different HR in every hospital? Where will the staff files be? Are they gonna be in a shared drive so it can be accessible, or is it gonna be just closed in your flagship hospital and every time you have an inspection, you're gonna walk in with those files? And then we also audit all the files every 6 months. We look for all the licensure, we look for the job description, the org chart, and so on. So we look at all the accreditation requirements, JCI, CAP, ISO, and so on. We listed them. So every 6 months, we go and we audit our HR department. We review our SOPs, make sure that their SOPs are approved, their employee handbook, and so on. We also audit the IT department. Again, managing IT across a network is not easy. There's a lot of requirement in terms of validation, in terms of interface, in terms of backup, and so on. So we created also audit checklists for the IT department, and every 6 months we audit those departments. Supply chain, contract, vendors, evaluation, and so on. And last, logistics. Samples, when you have a network of lab, network of hospitals, samples will be going around. So we want to make sure that our drivers are trained to handle any biological spill, and they have all the training need to understand how serious what they're dealing with in terms of samples. And I think now I covered two of what we have done in our lab. The last part is KPIs, or process improvement. In God we trust, all others bring numbers. So when it comes to KPIs, basic QA, we have a number of KPI required by accrediting agencies, maybe your critical result notification, some of the pre-analytical, like number of rejected samples, and so on. But lately, there are a lot of initiatives that you see at the local level and at the international level when it comes to KPIs. And I like to call it the carrot and sticks. So at the international level, many times, if they compare you to different hospitals around the world, and then you receive like a 5 stars, most likely you're going to have more patients come to your hospitals, so that's where the carrots come. If you are at a 1 star or 2 star, most likely not a lot of people will come to your laboratory or your hospitals, and you need to do a lot of work to improve that. So in the clinical lab, there are a number of indicators that we can monitor. Of course, when it comes to target, we look for a benchmark, and for our lab, we enrolled with the College of American Pathologists Q-Probe and Q-Track surveys, where we can find our target. The next step is we need to define our KPI in terms of inclusion and exclusion criteria. So for example, specimen rejection rate is one of our KPIs that we monitor. But the $1 million question is, what is the definition of specimen rejection rate? If I have the 5 people here in the front, and I ask them, what is your definition, and I give them a piece of paper to write, most likely everybody will have a different definition for rejection rate. So what we have done, we align our inclusion and exclusion criteria with the College of American requirements. So basically, you use this and we add it to our policy. We want to make sure we do this ahead of all the initiative from Abu Dhabi in terms of Jodah indicator and any international requirement that will ask us to compare our lab to other laboratories around the world. We also enrolled with the blood culture contamination rate, blood product waste. For example, blood culture contamination rate, what is the definition of a contaminated blood culture? Is it one bottle or two bottles? What kind of bacteria, and so on. So we continue to align our KPIs with the CAP Q-Probe and Q-Track survey. I think we are all aware of the DOH initiative. So far, we don't have a lot of laboratory-related Jodah indicator. Jodah is an Arabic word, which means quality. But I think in the near future, we can see more and more indicator. That's why we are kind of preparing our KPI. We're lifting it up a little bit to make sure that when the Jodah indicators are ready to add more to the clinical lab, our system will be ready to be in compliance with the requirements. Last but not least, I think in the US, they are doing something great when it comes to standardization. The hospital consumer assessment of healthcare providers and system. So these standardized patient satisfaction survey get distributed every year to more than 4,000 hospitals. 3 million patients every year fill that survey. And the survey is administered between 2 to 42 days after discharge. And it is required by the CMS, the Center for Medicaid and Medicare Services. So that's a great tool to compare different hospitals in terms of their patient satisfactions. Now patients are well informed with their decisions. They can go into the website, they can read every information about the hospital they want to visit, they can read about the doctor and so on. Very granular information that you can find. Patient nowadays, and everybody is looking for value, they don't look for volume. In summary, we spoke about pre-analytical errors and the importance of interdepartmental work to reduce them. We spoke about continuous survey readiness and the importance training the frontline staff in accreditation standard. We spoke about aligning our KPIs with the international requirement. We spoke about harmonization and standardization. And of course, quality is a journey and it's not a destination. So the next step is innovation. And I think the next talk will be about innovation. So we'd love to learn about it. Thank you.